Welcome to our event. I'm Ben Powell. I'm the director of the Free Market Institute here at Texas Tech University. Our mission is to promote the study and teaching of free market economics. And as part of that mission, one of the things that we do is sponsor about 4 lectures per semester on campus that are open to the student body, the general public. And we have a very special program for you tonight, because this isn't one of just our usual ones. This is done in partnership with a group that's doing the Free Market Roadshow. Texas Tech has become a co-sponsor with the Austrian Economic Center, the Liberty Fund, and other organizations that sponsor a Free Market Roadshow. Actually, Institute faculty fellow Ed Stringham has been a numerous time veteran of the tour. How many times have you been on?
Oh, almost every time.
Almost every time, and it's now in its 9th year. And it brings together academics, business people from United States and Europe. It tours throughout Europe doing panels on free markets and how governments in these countries are kind of mucking them up. And this year it's going to hit 37 cities. Barbara, actually, I've got your list
36.
Up here, right there. 36 cities. It's a grueling affair. I've been on it once before, and it's like a country per day that you visit while you're on it. And this year, the Free Market Institute's sending Kate Sheehan, Adam Martin, Ed Stringham, and myself all to participate in basically the length of the roadshow. And Barbara Cohn, who's the director of this program, is experimenting with bringing the program to the United States. And I think this is the first time that she's doing it in the United States. So she's brought 3 European academics with her, or her and 2 other academics familiar with Europe with her, to discuss what can the United States learn from Europe. And I think it's going to be a great panel. And I should also recognize that in addition to Dr. Combe, there's 3 members of the Liberty Fund here with us, the president, Chris Talley, vice presidents, Doug Denial and Emil Pacheco, who are over there. They helped sponsor this tour and bring it to Europe, and also are helping to bring it here to Texas Tech, and we thank them for their support as well. So what can the United States learn from Europe? I'm going to briefly introduce our 3 speakers right now. Then each one of them will give a short presentation about their aspect of the situation and what they think we could learn from Europe here in the United States. And then we'll jointly take questions for everybody at the end. Our first speaker is going to be Dr. Barbara Cohn. Dr. Cohn is the president of the Hayek Institute in Vienna, Austria, and the director of the Austrian Economic Center, as well as the intellectual entrepreneur behind the Free Market Roadshow. Dr. Cohn will explain why Europe has such high rates of unemployment among young people. Dr. Enrico Colabato is the professor of economics at the University of Turin in Italy. Dr. Colabato will speak about the stifling regulatory environment that is coming from the European Union out of Brussels. Dr. John Howard Bakalis is the managing director of Black Summit Financial Group and is also a professor of finance and economics at the University of Kentucky. He will explain what the United States could learn from Greece's recent financial meltdown. So with that, Dr. Cohn, welcome.
Thank you, Ben, for this warm welcome in this cold country. When I flew over yesterday from Europe, I was thinking, well, going to Texas is nice and warm, but eventually it's as icy cold here as it is back home in the Alps, in the Tyrol, or in Vienna. So, I would like to discuss a couple of hot issues that our youth in Europe faces, namely unemployment. And when Ben and I were discussing what would be of interest for you here in the United States, what are the hot topics that you can learn or should not learn from Europe, and I would rather say not copy and not make the same mistakes as our European politicians and obviously all our all the people following, namely the media and a couple of others who twist public opinion, then I would say be aware of not making the same mistakes and just learn from the best. And the best is probably keeping competition, keeping entrepreneurship, and cherishing the achievement principle. And none of these things are being done right now in Brussels. And Professor Colombato will talk about what is coming out of Brussels. And Professor Haralambakis will talk about what the results are of the bad policies in Brussels. And I will talk about the future that is lacking for our next generation. And a couple of young kids are leaving Europe or have to leave Europe because there is no way they find jobs, or there is no way that they can create jobs themselves because of the bad environment. And I'll just come up with a couple of facts and figures before I discuss with you what the consequences of minimum wage is. The sad facts and figures and numbers are, a quarter of the population in some European countries does not have a job and will not find any. So this is the case for Greece and Spain, Italy, France, and of course also a couple of other European countries are under stagnation. Lacks of reform, namely they don't do their homework. When I say they, it's the politicians. And having been in politics for 12 years myself, I'm allowed to bash politicians. And this, since this is the free state of Texas, I think we can do this as well, even more. U.S. unemployment rate is right now 6%. In Europe, we have an average of 10%. This in the EU countries, EU member states, namely average of 10%. However, there are nations, and I talked about a couple of them, that have higher, much higher unemployment rates. But for grown-ups, I'm talking for, you know, the ELMA. Greece, 27%. Spain, 24%. This is the average. I mean, it's a quarter of the population. Youth unemployment. How much do you think is youth unemployment? How high? Any ideas?
Double what you listed earlier.
22? Well, any other numbers?
40. 50. 60.
It's 55. In Spain, it's about the same number. In Greece, it's a little bit lower. In Italy, it's 44%. So these are the facts, the figures that we are being presented at with. So, I mean, if you're a young, if you're a graduate, where do you think you go? What do you think, what options do you have? So this is what the youth is facing. And the unemployment rate is still rising, and it's not part of as a result of the financial crisis, so-called financial crisis. We have the euro crisis, we have the sovereign debt crisis, and a couple of other institutional crises in Europe. So where are the reasons for that? The reasons are definitely bad politics, policies. And some of them are redistributional policies, and some of them are welfare state policies. And one of those policies, as a matter of fact, is the so-called minimum wage policy that we have implemented in all European countries. Germany was the last one this year that they came up with a minimum wage. How much do you think is a minimum wage in Germany for everybody and for every job?
It was around 10 euros an hour.
It's 8.5 euros an hour.
Oh.
Well, it's a little bit more than $10, but still, it's it is by law now, and we know from our first results and figures that it will cost a huge amount of jobs, and of course it costs a lot of additional regulation, and the additional labor, the labor market costs that will be result out of that are 10 billion euros, just for Germany only. So what is minimum wage? There are people, you all know these guys, who say compulsory unemployment, full stop. Or it simply makes it illegal to hire people. I mean, minimum wages, you know, keep people from going into the job market. Or as this gentleman, who you all probably know since you're students of Ed and Ben, and here at the Free Market Institute, it's as Mises said, it's mass, it produces mass unemployment. So why? First of all, it makes illegal to hire, because after all, you cannot get rid of those people anymore. Voluntarily, contracts are outlawed, and of course, it causes a lot of damage because of the legal situation. The wage is a price, and some principles governed by both. So if you see, if you all are familiar with that, and I quickly skip that, but these are the results and the obvious effects. So it's a reduction in the demand of labor, of course. When you came up with the recent rise of the United States and probably your president, a couple of other politicians came up with the idea of rising the minimum wage, all of a sudden people came up with the idea that it would rise the cost of fast food. And the Cato Institute has done a great study on that and has showed all of, how much a burger would be if the minimum wage would be risen, and how much a Subway sandwich would be, etc., etc. So you can start, you can look at those things. These are the negative effects. It will definitely hamper, it will definitely destroy consumption. And of course, it will drive more people out of work. The interesting thing also, if we look back at why minimum wages were invented a couple of 100 years ago, I would also already say, I mean, the first minimum wage laws date back to the 1870s in New Zealand, but also in Great Britain and in Europe in some places, but also here in the United States, you started out with that. It was actually to keep people from the job market, especially with females. The idea back then was we don't want them to be hired. So those who you want to protect are the ones who suffer in the end. You know, there are always well-intended ideas, but the consequences are bad, are mean. This is what Ben Powell pointed out earlier with the mean politics that we have in Europe. You know, it's easy if you say, you know, I'll give a present, me as a politician, I'll take your tax dollar and I redistribute it, and this is a present for you. And if you don't understand that you actually, in the end, pay for this yourself, then you're lost. And this is what, why we, for example, run the Free Market Roadshow, to explain this to people, because eventually if you have the media and they tell you all the nice glorious stories also about, you know, how easy it is to print money and how too easy it is to redistribute, and you pay and you live on the next generation's costs, because this is what we have been doing in Europe for a long time, then you definitely have to look at the results. And I see that Ben is already getting nervous, so I quickly skip through the next slides before I wrap up. So the hidden effects is, as I said, the reduction of the on-the-job training and, of course, the fringe benefits. Because, as I told you with the German figure and number that I gave you, the 10 billion, all of a sudden the employers, the business people, have a whole number of additional costs that they have to bear. And this is it. Again, the consequence is played out at the next at the next generation, at the young people who will not be hired. And when we look at, for example, what is happening at the Spanish job market or at the French job market, you cannot fire people anymore because of those labor laws. People they are protected by law. So if you as an entrepreneur are not happy with the performance, there is no chance you can fire the people. They have to stay in the job, and a minimum wage is even worse because you add this to the other negative effects. So in the end, it will be, of course, the consequences will be shifted to the consumers, and the results will be much higher unemployment. So why do you think we have those high rates of youth unemployment, and especially France, Italy, and Spain? Because of the bad regulation, and because of these, maybe with some people, even unintended consequences, because they thought it would be good, but it is not good. Eventually, because the market, the job market, and the price market, the price mechanism, well, is not working anymore. And if the price mechanism is not working anymore because of this intervention, you have those negative consequences. And of course, one of them is another result. There are a lot of studies that have been published in recent years, and to sum up, they all come up with the same solutions. It's the number of unemployed people is being risen because of minimum wage, and of course it delays hiring. So is this fair? I mean, in times of Piketty's and a couple of other well-meaning leftist socialists. There is no such thing as fairness on earth. I mean, I'm a Hayekian, so we just have to take it as it is, a matter of fact. And the only things that really work out is competition, the market, the achievement principle, and self-responsibility. So this is in a nutshell. So, but there is no fairness on earth. I mean, the sweatshops provide the least bad option for the workers who work in them. This is a quote by Ben Powell. And don't you think those guys definitely don't have minimum wages, and they don't have the labor protection, but they earn money and they have the opportunity to achieve and to grow. So the winners of minimum wages are those groups here, but it's actually those those politicians who buy the votes, nothing else. This is just an interesting example of the Salvation Army and what happened here in the United States when they were forced to pay minimum wage. They just went, they threatened the politicians to run out of service. And politicians were unable to provide the services that the Salvation Army presented. So, again, they had to stop the minimum wage for the Salvation Army. But the idea that the government would have to step in is not a good one. Walter Williams has been here and was with the Free Market Institute here. He's also one of these guys who definitely is not in favor of minimum wages. How to raise wages, increase productivity. This is something that, for example, the French government still has not understood. If 2/3 of the labor force in a country are directly or indirectly employed by the government, there is no such thing as productivity anymore. This is one of the reasons why our European markets are going down, why we lack economic growth, why we lack also individual freedom. And I would just like to leave it with that and quickly use one example by Arthur Laffer with his enterprise zones, where he completely showed in Chicago that it is working without government intervention, and that the markets, the markets for hiring and for the demand and supply side works best if you leave the people alone and let them bargain and barter and make free contracts and not let anybody else get involved. So I will keep it at that, and I'm looking forward to the discussion later. Thanks.
All right, Professor Colombano.
Barbara spoke about regulation, and especially regulation of the labor market. The question is actually a broader issue, because regulation does not happen by chance. It is, so to speak, designed. It is within the very spirit, say, and regrettably perhaps the future of the European Union. Just step back, and let's think and let's recall what the basics of the European Union was. Back in the 50s, it was not the European Union, it was the common market, and the idea was actually deregulation. As you might remember, or as you might have studied, the main thrust behind the common market, the common European era, was actually free trade. So it was deregulation in trade. And that was very much a free market view, and it was a swindle at the expense of the French. The French did not want it. The French got into trouble in Suez, so it was kind of a political bargain, so to speak, and the Germans, which should be grateful to them, and the Dutch just forced the French to get into the free market deal. And it was nice. It created a lot of wealth. It was the basis for the European growth back in the 60s and part of the 50s, and we still benefit from it now. The problem was that once you start an international organization. And once you try, you start appointing politicians to, say, federal, in this case, the federal European government, and you start to appoint a bureaucracy, they do not stop when their job is done. And rightly so, because they get privileges, they get salaries, they get nice pensions, they don't have much to do, and the main job is to try to keep staying where they are and making a career. Now you have one way of making a career, and the best way is to increase your responsibilities, at least on paper. You have two ways of doing that. Either you get the capacity to spend taxpayers' money, or if you don't have that, you have to expand the number of rules that you can issue. That is the beginning of regulation, and that is the beginning of a regulatory state. So what happened, basically, starting from the late 70s, when more or less free trade was obtained, free capital movements were all but obtained, people were not really moving so much, but that's okay. The state bureaucracy, well, the federal, the Euro bureaucracy, this nickname, the Eurocrats, started thinking about what are we going to do next. And of course, what they were going to do next is take care of citizens. How do you take care of citizens? You issue rules for their own welfare, safety, guarantees, and happiness. This was the way regulation started. Now you have two levels of regulation in Europe. One is the big game, which by and large responds to rent-seeking groups. So it's a rent-seeking game. So Gordon Tullock passed away a few days ago, but what he taught us since the 1960s is very much the name of the game today. So one is the big rent-seeking game that takes place through regulation. The other one is petty regulation, which keeps this petty bureaucracy alive. The petty regulation is the regulation that makes headlines. So for example, last month, the Brussels passed regulations on vacuum cleaners, air conditioning, domestic appliances. In the past, it regulated wine bottling, olive oil servings, and I don't know what kind of vegetables they were dealing with, but that is petty regulatory things, just to harass people or to elicit, say, some demand from distributors, large-scale distributors. But the real story, which is actually hampering growth in Europe, is the big game. What is the big game? The big game is basically try to deny competition within the European context. You can do that in different ways. You can issue regulation in the labor market. You can issue regulation in safety standards. You can issue regulation in a workplace conditions. You can issue regulation in production technologies and production procedures. The facade is to say, we do it for your own welfare, we do it because we want to give you safe products. But the cost of production of regulation and the cost of complying with regulation is vastly different across Europe. If you go to countries like, say, Italy, France, southern France, Spain, Greece, Eastern Europe, you have, by and large, small size and medium size enterprises. Those are the companies where fixed costs, and actually sunk costs in particular, with the fixed costs you cannot retrieve, are heavier. One thing is spending, say, $100,000 if your turnover is $1 billion. And one thing is to spend on regulation and bureaucracy and internal bureaucracy and internal controls if your turnover is, say, $1 million. Now, if you have to comply with the rules of the game issued by Brussels and you're a small or medium-sized company, you're out of business. That is, either you comply with the rules and you cannot afford it, or you just try to, say, forget about the rules and ignore the rules and hope that the police inspector will never come and make, pay you visits. Or if the police inspector comes and pay you visit, you want to have plenty of envelopes available so that you can find your way out. So basically what you have is one effect and an indirect effect. The direct effect is that you have big business trying to impose lots of costs that drive small and medium-sized companies out of business. Is this game going to be successful? By and large, yes, because big business can lobby the bureaucrats and the politicians in Brussels. Small business can't. Small companies in Italy, France, Spain, Greece, etc., they don't have the money to pay for lobbies, and therefore the lobbies follow the big boys. The problem is that the big boys don't care. After all, they're already complying with the procedures that the bureaucrats are going to pass. The small companies, as I said before, are out of business. What is the outcome? Underground economy, unemployment. Barbara said it before, you have two kinds of unemployment, overall unemployment, youth unemployment. Overall unemployment, the key figure is youth unemployment, because that tells you that companies are not hiring. And overall unemployment are fake figures, because given the impossibility to fire, first you have to go broke, and then you fire. Luckily, it takes some time to go broke, so the real unemployment figures you see are the youth unemployment figure, because that gives you, tells you how vibrant the labor market is. And high youth unemployment rates mean that the market is strangled. And it's not by chance that the market is dead. So you have those Spanish, French, well, not so much French, but French is pretty high too. Italian, Greek, and the rest of it, high youth unemployment figures. Because regulation is gradually killing small and medium-sized companies, and those economies are built and have built their past success on medium-sized and small-sized companies. People might say, okay, what's the problem? If you have regulation, and if regulation hits particularly hard small-sized company, why don't small-sized company grow? And this is where local regulation and high taxation hits. So Italian entrepreneurs, Spanish entrepreneurs, Greek entrepreneurs, and Central and Eastern European entrepreneurs, they look at the figures and say, what should we do? Should we try to grow and pay taxes? Look, taxation in Southern Europe, overall in Europe, is extremely high already. It's not just the taxation you see in the tax bill, it's Social Security. Social Security and taxation means practically that for each dollar you pocket as your salary, your employer pays between $2 and $2.50. So the only way you can afford an employee that takes home $1 and pay for him actually $2.50 is tax evasion. Now, if you clamp down on tax evasion, the company goes out of business. So you are actually in a trap. If you try to follow the incentives created by a heavy regulatory structure, you go into the world of taxation and you die because taxation is too high. If you don't want to get that taxation, you have to go to the underground economy. And the underground economy is coming under pressure. luckily, as I think Milton Friedman said, every dollar of tax evasion is $1 that you do not give. It's not wasted away by government. But government is very effective in coming after you, and it's becoming increasingly effective. So the new, let's say, the outcome and the new phenomenon that we're witnessing in Europe right now is corruption. That's the only way out. According to the polls, about 75% of Europeans believe that corruption is a very significant problem throughout the Union. And about 65% of the polls of the interviewed in the surveys believe that it is a rising problem. So it's not just stable, it's increasing. What is the cost of corruption? According to an EU estimate, so there are official figures, and it's actually been disclosed by EU commissioner, we are paying, in terms of missed out opportunities, 120 billion euros a year. 120 billion euros, that's about $150 billion every year. And it's growing. And that does not take into account migration. Because, as Barbara is saying, it's not just a matter of workers going away. It's business that is going away. We are full of bright entrepreneurs. But if you have a bright idea, you think twice before you develop it in Europe. If you have a chance, you come over here, you go to Australia, New Zealand, maybe China or India, then you go away. And this is something that does not show up in the figures, but it does show up in low or negative growth. Bear in mind that when it comes to growth, you have three elements that explain, let's say, the growth phenomenon. One is taxation, the other one is judiciary, that is, to which extent your property rights, your private property rights are protected, and third is regulation. I'm fairly skeptic about econometric exercises, but when the correlation is high and all the econometric, say, exercises go in the same direction, maybe there is a grain of truth. But apparently taxation matters in slowing down growth, but it's not the main component. The main components are bad judiciary and excessive regulation. If you look at the data, what matters is not taxation, but is economic freedom. And economic freedom right now boils down to regulation. Why do we persist? Why do bureaucrats persist in their regulatory politics? And why policies? And why do they continue to issue tons, literally, tons of paper, thousands of rules every year? Well, on the one hand, it's because the more rules you issue, as I said before, the safer is your job as a bureaucrat. The other thing is that the more regulation you issue, the better your chances of making a career, because your office, your bureau increases, and therefore you're no longer, you're not commanding a platoon, you're commanding a company, perhaps a battalion, therefore you're no longer a lieutenant, you become captain, major, colonel, whatever. And this is what the bureaucrats are trying, to transform platoons into battalions, and they're doing it very successfully. The other thing is that you have, the more you regulate, the more you create a demand for European services. That is, regrettably, the overall situation in which we are in Europe is that when you have a problem, you don't look at the mirror and you don't ask yourself, what can I do about it? No, you look out of the window and you say, now what can a bureaucrat do for me? So it is a vicious loop in a way, according to which the more regulation you create, the more regulation you introduce, the greater the demand for your services is going to be. And that's not, something that's going to stop very soon, because people today in Europe are criticizing the European Union, but they're not criticizing EU regulation. They are criticizing the euro, which John will probably talk about, and they're criticizing the euro for the wrong reason. That is, they want to get out of the euro basically because they want to monetize public debt. They don't want to have a better currency. Much as the euro has been a disaster, they want even worse currencies. Italians want to get out of the euro because they want to print liras. Greeks want to get out of the euro because they want to print drachmas. And the same for the French, same for the Spaniards. I mean, the anti-euro story is not because they don't believe that the regulators can deliver. they believe that they're not delivering enough. So we want our printers. We don't trust Frankfurt and the Frankfurt printing machine. And therefore, the future is going to be, we must give, and this is really bad omen, and it's very sad. We want to give Europe much more responsibilities for social welfare, labor regulation, state, which are going to become federal pension systems. That is, we're not happy with the way they ruined us through regulation and taxation. We want them to ruin us even deeper by hoping that a European regulator can do better than a local politician. The answer, and I'm going to stop, has been mixed. As you might have seen right now, the European Parliament has been, say, populated by Eurosceptics, but they're not really going against the Eurocrats. They're not killing regulators. Our Eurocrats are people who think they can be better regulators than the previous generation of regulators. So don't be fooled by Eurosceptics. Most of European Eurosceptics are really, so to speak, better regulators, different regulators. We can do it better. They will never do it better. They will just create additional layers of regulation. And don't forget that when it comes to regulation, you never have a generation of a layer of regulation that replaces the previous layer. It's always one layer on top of the other. And the more layers you have, the less growth you're going to have. So the recommendation is look at us and stay away from what we've been doing. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Kalambato. Professor Harlan Lobakis, would you like to join us and tell us about Greece and what we can learn from them?
Good evening. It's a great pleasure to be among you tonight. A company made an announcement that they want to hire a person with strong quantitative skills. So they decided to interview a mathematician, a statistician, and a bureaucrat. So the mathematician steps in and says, good morning, what can I do for you? He says, it's a very simple question. 2 + 2. He looks at them and says, are you kidding me? 2 + 2 always has been 4, always will be 4. I have a PhD in mathematics. I'm offended. I don't want to work for you. Fine. The statistician comes in and says, what can I do for you? You know, statisticians, they always talk about the margin of error. So they say, it's a simple question, 2 + 2. The statistician says, 2 + 2 is usually 4 with a margin of error ±5%. They liked it. So the bureaucrat now comes in. He's a high official from the European Union, an economic official, says, what can I do for you? Just 2 + 2. Just a second. Can I close the door? So he closed the door. Can I pull the curtain? He pulls the curtain. Just, is that between you and me? Says, yes. How much you want it to be? That's unfortunately what has happened in the European Union. They took a wonderful dream, and that dream was free trade, free movement of capital, of ideas, of people, and the dream became a nightmare. And they have destroyed country after country. I remember it was Tuesday, February 26, 2012. But let me give you the background of that. I was in New York in May 2012. I was meeting with a client. He's a Cypriot American. He says, you know, you have done good for my portfolio. I talked to the president of the country in Cyprus, and he wants to meet you. He says, meet me? Who am I? He says, yes, they will fly you there, and he has a specific request. So I fly to Cyprus in late May 2012. I meet with the president. I said, what can I do for you? He says, we have a bank. I said, really? Yeah. The bank is called Cyprus Popular Bank, in Greek, Laiki Bank. I says, what can I do about the bank? He says, we have a problem. Yeah, what's the problem? We need $3 billion. I said, okay, can I see the books? But they bring the books. I look at this. Say, the bank is bankrupt. Just close it down, shut it down. Says, we cannot find any American fund to bring, you know, $3 billion. Forget it. I says, who can invest? I said, look, you need to look at your competitive advantages. That's what free markets do. What is your competitive advantage? There is a great Texan company by the name of Noble. Noble recently discovered offshore Cyprus trillions of cubic feet of natural gas. So what you have to do, take this bank and convert it into an energy bank. There is no energy bank in all of Europe. That's your competitive advantage. Then, if you are willing to do that, I can take it to CITIC, one of the largest Chinese banks. I work with the CEO there. Maybe they will be willing to pour $3 billion of equity capital and convert it into an energy bank. Are you willing to do it? I said, sure. So to make the long story short, I fly to China. I get the commitment from CITIC to invest $3 billion of equity. But listen to this. Before I close the door in the presidential palace, says, John, I have one more question. I says, yes. We also need 10 billion euros, that's almost $14 billion, because we have a deficit. And you were waiting for 2 hours to tell me you need an additional 14 billion? So you need 14 billion for the state, 3 billion for the bank. How much is the GDP? 17 billion. that's what you, bureaucrats have done. They have bankrupt country after country. So, of course, the president, the formerly from a socialist communist party of Cyprus, never understood what a collateral is. He didn't want to give the collateral, so the Chinese pulled out. So on February 26, 2013 now, a few months later, I was in Lebanon. I get a call. It was Michael Sarris, the newly appointed Minister of Finance for Cyprus. The president had lost the election 2 days ago, and a conservative president had taken over. So, John, I was trying to find you on your American cell phone. I couldn't find you, so I found you on your European. Where are you? Are you in Greece? Are you in Europe? I said, I'm in Lebanon. Oh, you're next door. The new president wants to meet you, and, we'll fly you over. So a couple of days later, I go to meet the new president. They pick me up at the airport. On the way to the airport, Michael Sarris, the newly appointed Minister of Finance, gets a call. And the call was from Mario Draghi. Mario Draghi is the president of the European Central Bank and Olli Rehn. Olli Rehn was, until, about 10 days ago, the Minister of Finance for all the European Union. So he puts them on speakerphone, and I can listen now to the conversation. He said, Mr. Sarris, you need to know that your country is bankrupt, your banks are bankrupt, we're going to confiscate the deposits. And they did. On March 15th, 2013, less than a month later, Cypriot depositors lost all their money. That's what happens when bureaucrats take over. They destroyed countries. Still, there are capital controls in Cyprus. They announced that those capital controls will be lifted in 3 months. A year and a half later, they're still there. My fear is that if we let bureaucrats run our countries through the regulations, and because they have never run businesses, they're going to destroy not just the European Union, but the globe. And if we look at just the unfunded liabilities throughout the European Union or in our own country here in the United States, the unfortunate thing is that we're bankrupt. So let me give you an example. If I take Japan, the Japanese debt as a fraction of GDP is between 225 and 250%. That's an unsustainable debt. The Japanese economy pretty soon will be bankrupt. Because if we look at their savings rate, it has disappeared. If we look at the demographics, oh my goodness. You want to move just a little bit west of Japan and go to China? That's the Great Wall of Steroids. How many bubbles are there? Where can I start? The municipal sector? Should I look at the banks, the non-performing loans of banks? They keep, postponing, so the bond is due, the bond comes to be paid, and they roll it over, and they accumulate more debt upon debt. You know, prosperity bottom credit has never worked. and will never work. If I go to Europe and I take the great country of Germany and I take into account from an actuarial perspective the promises made to future generations, and I would only go for 17 years. So until approximately 2032, 2033, the true debt of Germany as a fraction of GDP is close to 300%. I'm sorry, Germany is bankrupt. I don't even want to touch France. You understand why? As far as the country where I was born, Greece, that's almost 850%. So why did Greece go bankrupt? Simply because they created three things. Number one, a huge government. And the definition of government is inefficiency, wasteful, and corrupt. At least, that's in my book. So, the dream of a young person in Greece was to become a government bureaucrat and get $700,000-$800,000 but kept job security. So, the big state eventually destroyed incentives and the youth lost the ability to dream. And when the youth lose the ability to dream, the country is gone. Number two, they made many promises, and how did they finance those promises? With IOUs, with bonds. They sold those bonds, and the unfortunate thing is that there are those investment banks that without even looking at what was the collateral behind it, they financed those bonds. And according to the greater fool theory, I'm a fool, I'm gonna buy this bond because I'm gonna find a greater fool to buy it. Really? Is a bond an asset? No, a bond is a third party liability. So let's keep accumulating liabilities. And that's how Greece eventually was destroyed. Because they made promises, they created a huge state, and the bonds eventually had to experience a 50% haircut. And the 50% haircut eventually was, the consequence of the haircut went to the Cypriot banks, because the Cypriot banks had not invested in real assets, but in Greek bonds. So that's how the Cypriot bank went down, because it invested in IOUs. How many IOUs are out there? Our own debt in this country exceeds 300% of GDP. Don't listen to the official statistics that they tell us that the debt is 96% of GDP. We have made promises, and if we look again from an actuarial perspective, at the Social Security unfunded liability, and all the Medicare and Medicaid promises were over 300%. So unless we reverse course pretty soon, we're going to be haunted. And we're going to be haunted for one additional reason. Because financial institutions, not in this country, I believe that we have strong financial institutions, but we live in an age of globalization. And one institution's asset is another institution's liability. So when Bank A has invested in a liability of a European bank, and I very much doubt how many healthy banks we can find in Europe, and I will justify why I say that, then our own institutions can become pretty shaky. So let me justify why I say that European institutions are very shaky because of bureaucrats. Because they created a huge liabilities by issuing bonds, and eventually the banks bought those bonds. And by buying those bonds, they thought that they're gonna get a yield of 4%, 5%, 6%, or 2% these days, and they have a safe asset. Yeah, but if I look at UniCredit credit, with all due respect to my good friend from Italy, Enrico, UniCredit's Texas ratio, are you familiar with the Texas ratio? It was invented here in this great land. In 1989, many savings and loans institutions in the state of Texas had huge financial problems. Because when you take the non-performing loans of a bank and divide it by the equity of the bank, that's the Texas ratio. When the Texas ratio starts exceeding 60, 65, 70%, the bank is going down. UniCredit? Over 95%. BNP Paribas, the largest French bank, I don't need even to tell you about this. Deutsche Bank, the synthetic products of Deutsche Bank, it's infinite, cannot even be calculated. Well, let me tell you why not. I'll tell you another story. So you see, I changed my presentation completely. Sorry. It was November 2007. I took some of my students, back then I was teaching full time, to New York. I had a good friend at Bear Stearns. So we went to Bear Stearns. He made a great presentation how the bond market works. He takes the students to the trading floor. I had taught my students the week before what level three assets are. So let me remind you what a level three asset is. A level three asset is when the financial institution creates its own algorithm and assigns a value to an asset. So this asset, which is a piece of paper, has no secondary market. So nobody buys, nobody sells it. But I have it in my balance sheet. So this asset now, I create an algorithm and I assign a value to this asset, $100 million. So I write in my books as $100 million worth of asset. So my student, Henry, raises his hands and says to the managing director, says, with all due respect, could you please tell me how many of your assets here, the fifth largest investment bank in the United States, Bear Stearns, how many of your assets are level three assets? He looks at me because he knew where the question was coming from. Always has been an honest man. Says about 65%.
Oh.
And here he says, so you're going down, right? March 14th, 2008, less than 6 months later, Bear Stearns went back. That is happening. That is going to happen again. If you think we experienced a crisis in 2008, guess what? It was a joke. Okay? If you think the 1930s was tough, guess what? That was a joke. Okay? Get ready. Some very tough days are ahead of us. Don't want to scare you. But you need to get prepared. Okay? And we need to protect our institutions, our families, our country, because some tough days are coming ahead of us. So since Ben gave me a sign of, I have three, 4 minutes, I'm going to use maybe two or three slides from what I had prepared. What is capital? Capital is the ability to extract value out of dormant resources. So can we identify dormant resources, sleeping assets, and are we able to extract value out of those sleeping assets? What is wealth creation? It's the ability to accumulate capital as defined before and create streams of income. That's what wealth creation is about. What is economic growth? It's the ability to create wealth. Nations which have been successful in doing this are experiencing significant economic growth. Chinese did it in the 1980s and in the 1990s, in the beginning of the 21st century. But why? Because they liberalized their markets. That's what classical liberalism is about, discovering dormant resources. Now, what the bureaucrats have done, they have done centralization. What Europe needs and what the United States needs is decentralization. So we don't have the time to go through the effects of centralization or, you know, the effect of deregulation. But I just want to show you this figure. It's a study done that says, if we had dropped the level of regulation in this country, in our own country, and look at our GDP, instead of being close to $16 trillion, would have been approximately $54 trillion. Regulation kills the economies. Regulation kills incentives. So, don't trust, as Dr. Colm said in the beginning, don't trust politicians. The stars are not moving in Europe because it's overregulated. What we need is to create incentives in order to avoid the dream to become a nightmare. And to close from a classical literature. You know, Dante is experiencing in Divine Comedy three and nine circles. So the European Union is going through those nine circles. The limbo phase was in 1992. And maybe some of you were not even born in 1992. But eventually the European Monetary Union experienced such a shock that was almost abolished. The phase of lust was created through the Maastricht Treaty. The gluttony phase between 2001 and 2004. Greed between 2005 and 2008. Anger between 2009 and 2011, when eventually they were exposed that the emperor was naked. The heresy phase of Mario Draghi, with all due respect to Mario Draghi, you know, I'm going to save the euro at all costs. The euro needs to go down because it's the most dysfunctional currency ever developed. Because that dysfunctional currency eventually destroys and keeps destroying people's savings. And I'm still waiting for the violence phase that I believe started last year with the confiscation, and want to see what the fraud phase and the treachery phase will bring. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I'll ask all three of my panelists to come up and grab a seat at the table and we can have questions. While they are, when I was listening to Dr. Colombato's talk, I was actually reminded of an experience on the Free Market Roadshow with Dr. Stringham, Dr. Kolb, and President Talley from a couple years ago. For those of you who know us, you might not be surprised to learn that we engaged in a black market transaction while we were on the tour, and it was a direct result of EU regulation. We were at Dubrovnik on the Croatian coast, and we were driving to Bosnia. I won't tell you exactly what time, but I will let you know that it was in the AM, that I ran into Dr. Kolb in a wine shop in town before our bus was departing. And I was looking for a particular, but it was a wine tasting room, actually, shop as a euphemism. I was looking for a wine by a famous winemaker. They didn't have any there, but I learned that his vineyard was only about 2 hours out of our way on the bus trip that we were going on that day. And we immediately decided it would be a great idea to drive that way in order to purchase some wine at the vineyard because their website indicated that they might be open. Well, we drove all this way. It was a beautiful drive, but it was 2 hours out of our way. And we get there, and there was pictures of me in front of the door with a very sad face that Dr. Stringham took because nobody was answering. We went 2 hours out of our way, and there was nobody there. And then eventually the next picture shows me like super happy because Barbara actually traced down somebody living behind the property who came and opened it up for us. But it was an interesting tasting experience. They said, because do you all have cash? Well, yeah, we have cash. We can pay in cash. So we paid in cash. Didn't really think that much of it at the time for the tasting. Then I was purchasing some bottles. She says, we'll need cash for the bottles too. I said, okay, I can pay you cash. Actually, I had to borrow cash from Barbara. But I can pay you cash for the bottles. And they said, oh, it's very nice of you to be, you know, so accepting of this. A lot of people don't understand that we can't use our credit card machine on the weekend. I thought, I just assumed that they didn't have a credit card machine. I said, on the weekend? No. Well, what's the problem? They said, well, you see, it's only my husband and I who work here. And we've hit the maximum work hours allowed under the European Union rules. So we just had you here as friends tasting today. And it was nice of us to give us this friendly gift of cash while you were here. So with that, I'll open it up for questions from the audience.
Dr. Stringham asked why the United States is becoming more like Europe. Quick answer, there is something like public choice theory, and there is something that, you know, politicians buying votes, and if you have a society where only 10% contribute to the wealth in form of paying taxes, and the rest, which is the case, for example, in Austria, my home country, in Germany, in many other places, 60% do not pay taxes, literally. They are just, you know, recipients of welfare and of redistribution. But they vote for the guys. So it's as simple as that, unfortunately. In order to remain free, and, you know, individual freedom is our freedom is, I think, the highest good that we have to protect. We have to speak up and make sure that you don't fall into the same trap.
If I understand your question correctly, you're asking whether there are special laws or exemptions for McDonald's in Italy? The answer is no. So McDonald's or whoever has to work according to the law of the Italian government, say Greek government or German government. And if it's not profitable enough and you cannot break even, you just don't open a McDonald's in Italy. You stay out. That explains why you have a lot of kebab.
So the question is, what's going to happen with the European banks and the many problems they're facing, or you know, maybe those problems will come to this country? I think they're trying to kick the can down the road by using the powers of the central bank and cover up the problems. So at this point, both our own Fed, our own central bank, is buying up, quote, the assets, end of quote, of other financial institutions in order to postpone the inevitable. And that's why the Fed's balance sheet eventually went from $700 billion to close to $5 trillion. Almost one third of our GDP is in the balance sheet of the Fed. And I still remember Andrew Jackson's tombstone. I don't know if you've ever visited the tombstone of Andrew Jackson. Anybody? You know, not even his name is there. It says just one thing: I killed the bank. That was the old central bank. Now, anytime you hear central banks or central authorities accumulate too much power, things collapse. That always has happened. Why? Because they're cheapening the currency. Isn't that one of the main reasons that the Roman Empire eventually was dissolved? Because the dinar was 100% backed up by silver. And then the 100% became 95%. And at the end of the Roman Empire, it was just 5%. Remember, in 1 year, there were 5 emperors. Why? Because one was killing the next. Because they were promising higher wages, more salaries. Yeah, more salaries. How did they do that? By cheapening the currency and eventually blowing the deficit of the country.
A tiny follow-up. My bet is that what's going to happen is they're going to monetize debts, both government debts and banking non-performing loans. So the big question is, what's going to happen with all that liquidity around? For the time being, nothing is happening because the liquidity comes in and people don't spend it, basically. So if you look at the data in the macro vocabulary, you would say that the liquidity preference has boomed, which is true. So you have massive injections of liquidity, the demand for liquid assets has increased, and that does not show up in the price increase. Big question is, what happens when people sooner or later will try to spend that money and there is no collateral, because spending money is not equivalent to the production of goods and services. Okay? Money does not create wealth. Wealth is what you produce. And when you have an excess money supply, and you're going to have inflation. So the big question, and if I had to steal your job for a moment, is the big challenge is, where are your assets going to be when inflation will erupt? Or who's going to pay the inflation tax? This is the next step, let's say, in the European history.
One of the main problems in developing countries is that they suffer from the Dutch disease. They have one particular asset, could be oil, it could be diamonds, whatever. And there is so much corruption around that asset that the country depends upon the exploitation of one asset to grow. Has never happened. Unless you develop the rule of law as a fundamental principle, those countries will never experience growth or development. And certainly, growth is a necessary condition for development, because development is considered the wholeness of the human being is being elevated, the standards of living are elevated. But if the country depends just on one asset, when the price of that asset, let's say it's oil, and the price of oil have dropped 25% in the last month or in the last 2 months, and they could still go down, that country eventually cannot depend only on one asset in order to increase. It has to do holistic development, and holistic development starts with the rule of law. Then you need to have some physical infrastructure, you need to have private initiatives in order to create businesses, and you need to give incentives. Without profits and good profit margins, the country cannot grow.
Question regarding cryptocurrencies that are arising, like Bitcoin and stuff like that, is that going to be maybe a more feasible solution to the problem, just kind of arising, kind of your own underground economy using these cryptocurrencies, instead of trying to actually dismantle the regulation associated with a lot of the fiat currencies that are, because basically, you know, maybe if you had more businesses using those cryptocurrencies, you could effectively just evade government intervention. Is that something that is feasible, or maybe a better solution in lieu of trying to actually tear down the current regulations that are in place?
So far, the European Union and the European politicians try everything not to allow those currencies and not to allow the experiments. Eventually, I mean, competition of money is always good.
Well, about cryptocurrencies, look, all these currencies, fiat paper currencies and whatever, are an illusion. Right? I accept it as a means of payment because I believe that somebody else will do the same with what I have. So the more you create illusions, the less comfortable I am. So if you tell me that a cryptocurrency actually has collateral, that the collateral is, say, gold, oil, beef, whatever, but I want to see the real thing, that I'm happy with that. But if you tell me that it's the collateral, it's just the belief that somebody else will be fooled as much as you are going to be tomorrow, I freak out. So I would be very cautious. Okay, the question is, given the fact that a bureaucratic state is bad and it's going to damage growth, how are we going to stop that? There is no easy solution, that's the easy answer. It's a matter of culture, I think, and education. You must have, you know, bureaucrats grow in a country that has lost the sense of individual responsibility. We vote for bureaucrats because we believe that the government can do something for us. We have to change the way people think, or, you know. So I would agree with John when he says that the only way out is to go through some kind of catastrophe, so that people eventually understand that the solution to individual problems is not socializing the problem. You take your own responsibilities. And if you are unemployed, try to find a job. Don't ask the government to find a job for you. If you are sick, try to find a way of buying your own health services. Don't ask the government to guarantee your health. So it's actually a matter of education, individual responsibility, is the ethics of choice and the ethic of making mistakes and accepting the consequences. This is something that Europe has lost. My impression that America is following us, but you can still change course before doomsday. I think that we are too far down the lane to go back. So we have to go against the wall, get the bruise, and perhaps later start again.
The question was, why are we lacking of the so-called Mittelstand, of the small and medium-sized companies that do exist and that were and are the backbone of the European economy, especially the German or the Austrian one. They contribute a lot of the taxes, they take the risk, and they are very productive. I think this is the key element that we all know. So they are destroyed by overregulation, as Professor Colombato pointed out, because they are not in the position of standing up and fighting those regulations. They just take them, they have to deal with it, work even harder, After all, I mean, those entrepreneurs are working 24/7. I mean, here in this country, this is taken for granted. In Europe, unfortunately, this is not taken anymore. I mean, you work from Monday to Friday, well, maybe in Austria and in Germany, and in some other countries, you stop working on Thursdays. So the average working hours are, you know, much, much lower than here. So among many other issues, those over-regulations that killed, and I think there are plenty of other reasons.
If I just may add to that, I'm not necessarily a great admirer of the German way of working and operating, but there is but there is a big difference between a small-sized German company and a small-sized Italian company. And the main difference is that the small and medium-sized German company is actually a branch of the large company. I mean, all this world of medium-sized and small companies are actually integrated in the large company model typical of the German system. So that you have, for example, large long-term contracts. And even if you're a small company, you can rely on a long-term contract with a large company. That allows you to develop new products, innovation. It gives you a time horizon. And given the fact that the Germans are German, and therefore the tax system does not change very frequently, laws, legislations used to be very constant, rather constant. They're no longer the same, so this is why they're going down the drain as well. But until recently, the small and the large company were integrated. In Italy, everybody on its own. And that's not a recipe for success. So the small and medium-sized company is a fake. They're not really small and medium-sized. There are small sections of a large company, and that makes a huge difference, especially in export markets. And when you're global, I mean, if a Chinese client comes to you and you're a small Italian company and asks you for 1 million units or something, the Italians say, I can give you 10. You're out of business.
And I can give us one final question, probably, sir.
Are you saying in Europe that all of the small and medium privately owned companies are disappearing?
If they paid taxes, yes, they would disappear. The lifeline is tax evasion. And also rules dodging. So, you know.
Creativity.
Yes.
I thank you all for coming and our panelists for a great presentation.